Hi, I'm Bridget Green.
And I'm Kevin Weber. And today we're talking about...
And building...
Small form factor PCs.
So small.
So good to have you here, finally.
I heard you want to talk about technology. You don't have to twist my arm too hard on that topic.
I have hot goss.
Bring up.
The bring up. Bridget. She's dead. You may not like it, but this is what peak performance looks like.
Hello, and welcome to The Bring Up, where today we have something a little bit different in store for you guys.
Yes, we're excited to be joined a little bit later by one of our friends from ASUS, who is going to be providing some really awesome hardware for us to be building not one, but two small form factor PCs.
But first, before we get into all of this building fun, let's do a little housekeeping.
The boring stuff.
So as always, folks, we are looking to hit that 5,000, check it, 5,000 likes on this video to get Dr. Lisa Su as a guest on our show. Kevin, before we build a small form factor PC, why would you want one? What's the deal with small form factor PCs? Other than, of course, they're adorable.
Yes. So, I mean, if you had, say, a regular size table and chairs that we're sitting at, it's
lame.
Whatever. But if you had a very tiny table and chairs hosted by an equally tiny Lisa Su, well, that's just delightful.
Oh, delightful.
So the biggest and most obvious reason why you'd want a small form factor system is if you just can't sacrifice the desk space, or you don't want to give up that precious floor space with a giant full tower system. So for comparison, this is your average small form factor size. You know, it's like more maybe on the tinier end. Whereas this is your standard, you know, run-of-the-mill ATX system.
Kevin, I think that you've been making so many workstation PCs lately that you've actually lost touch with what a normal PC looks like.
I don't know what you're talking about.
Okay. Anyway, another great use case for a small form factor PC is having something to take with you to a LAN event.
Sure.
Mobile gaming. Also, if you're home for the holidays and stuck in your childhood bedroom all day, having one of these guys might make it a lot more enjoyable. Of course, you do have your Smash Mouth poster to look at, so...
That's true.
At least there's that.
Oh.
Tiny Lisa. Oh, God, no. I'm so sorry,
so sorry, Tiny Lisa. Another great reason why you might want a small form factor PC is they make great home entertainment systems. Mm-hmm. So if you have a media center or a shelf that you just want to tuck it away discreetly in, that's a great option.
Yep.
Also, a lot of the small form factor boards have Wi-Fi and Bluetooth built in. So if you play your cards right, you can make it so that you only have to deal with a power cable and a display cable, and the rest of it can just be wireless.
And then, of course, there's how we in the AMD video studio have been using our small form factor PC, which is this little guy here that we affectionately call Baby Driver. So we have to travel a lot doing event coverage and product launch, things like that. So at those, sometimes we'll be having a quick turn edit. Where you're maybe ingesting a full, you know, 2-hour show and having to render that out. Sometimes it's the kind of thing that even the most powerful editing laptop just can't quite hack it at. So this has been a huge help just in our on-location editing workflow.
That's right. And it's also really important that we have something that can travel with us securely. So Baby Driver actually fits in a standard size carry-on hard case, so we can carry it with us on the plane versus having to check it and let it fall into the deep, dark underbelly of the airplane where we may never see it again or it might get broken.
So if you're a content creator, something like this might be a big help for you.
Yeah, for sure.
So Kevin, before we get into the build, I have a little bit of a confession to make.
Oh, I know about the bodies. Oh, no, different confession. My bad.
Yes, so I'm a content creator, been an editor for many years.
Many years.
PC lover, user.
User.
But I am actually not a PC builder, in that I have not built a PC before.
Yeah, that is maybe the one criterion.
Right.
Yeah.
You know, I've been build adjacent many times. I've actually been part of filming many builds.
Many builds.
I've been pretty intimidated, I won't lie.
Well, first of all, I want to say I'm proud of you for living in your truth.
Thank you, Kevin.
It's very impressive, but I think you're in a good position because not a lot of people get their first time with two professional PC builders at their side to help them out.
It was definitely helpful to have you there, to have JJ from ASUS there with us. So without further ado, let's check out Baby's first build.
So we are joined here today by JJ Guerrero, who has brought us a ton of different components to build a couple pretty badass little small form factor builds.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm really excited to be here. Thanks for inviting me.
When ASUS announced their support for the Ryzen 3000 series motherboards, I just remember seeing that slide where they were like 30 motherboards or something that were, you know, like all Ryzen 3000 ready. Yeah. And there was a bunch of different tiers of those as well. And can you break down what those different sort of like tiers or brands are and what each of them specialize
in? Yeah, for sure. When we first talk about motherboards, and especially in PC DIY, you're going to be talking gaming. So we actually have three different series of motherboards. And starting kind of from our entry, our good position, we have a fairly new series, and that's going to be our Tough Gaming line. Yeah, this has really been kind of tailored towards first-time builders. So people that are maybe a little bit more aggressive in terms of their price point, but still looking for, of course, ASUS quality, reliability, durability. I still say a gamer-related aesthetic and improvements in audio networking specifically tailored towards gamers. Gotcha. And so that's what we have here within kind of your system, a really great foundation to give you a good gaming experience. As we move up, though, we're going to go, of course, into our ROG family. You know, we're now nearing our 15th anniversary. It's really kind of been proven as an outstanding gaming brand. And the Strix series, it improves all the areas that you would expect. So component quality gets improved. You get more RGB aesthetics, more connectivity. And overall, you're going to have higher tiers of performance for respective components that have improved upon. And then we go to what you're actually going to be building, which is our formal ROG, our flagship series of product. So this is really kind of where we push the envelope. We actually try to have the absolute best of the best based technology. So the best components that we can put on board, the most advanced innovation in terms of hardware design, aesthetic implementation, connectivity, really for somebody that's looking for the best of the best in any respect.
Which is me.
Exactly, 100%. Whether it's going to be you know, aesthetics, modding, you know, water cooling, overclocking, mm-hmm. you're really going to want to look towards ROG.
So today we are focusing on small form factor builds, mm-hmm. and I think we're doing both a mini ITX and a MATX.
Yep.
So can you talk a little bit about the special considerations you might want to take in
yep.
when you're picking what goes into these?
And it can actually be a little bit tricky, a little bit challenging. There's sometimes different things to factor in. So, you know, here, just for reference, you know, we've got an ATX-based motherboard. So this is what, you know, over 70% of the market traditionally will build in. But when you do go more compact, there are a couple of things that you're going to want to keep in mind. So I'd probably say the first and most important thing is going to be compatibility. So kind of accounting for that physically, these items are compatible within the environment that you're going to install in. So the chassis is going to influence that a lot. So the case that you pick, you want to account for that those components all physically can work
sure.
in that smaller volume, right? And you're not causing obstructions. Also, there's an aspect of aesthetics that play into that, right? If you go too small, you may kind of take away from some of the visual aesthetic that you want to have. So
yeah.
maybe you want to go a little bit bigger, still smaller than, of course, a larger system, but you still want to be able to see a little bit more. Like you want to see a little bit more of that RGB lighting, the fans, the cooler, maybe the motherboard, the graphics card. So you want to balance that out. So compatibility relative to the overall volume of the chassis you're building in. The other big one I'd say is going to be thermal characteristics. As you shrink things down, it's mm-hmm. going to be a little bit more challenging to deal with airflow and making sure that everything is really well cooled. Now, Ryzen's very efficient and actually manage temperatures really well, and we do a lot in terms of board design, graphics card design to keep things really cool and reliable, but there are factors you want to account for, like the Wraith cooler. It's a really great solution and actually might work better in a smaller form factor build because you're going to have direct airflow that cools down the CPU and even the adjoining components like your M.2, mm-hmm. your memory, and your motherboard. But it might not look as cool as, let's say, your AIO cooler that you've got there, which will help to keep everything really nice, cool, and stable, and aesthetically might look a little bit more pleasing. So, you know, you just have to account for what's going to be the right thermal configuration as far as your components go, how much airflow you're introducing into the system, and things along those lines.
So you gave me the easy job of just with all the beginner parts, no complicated RGB stuff, and then Bridget's gonna have really complicated
build. Because he knows I'm ready for a challenge.
Yeah, that's fair.
It's not gonna be that much of a challenge. We've got a good set of hardware, you know, it's just a little bit more to do, but even on, you know, the connectivity, you're still gonna have a little bit to go through because we're still gonna RGB up this system right here, but
okay,
you know,
cool.
we're gonna have two definitely distinct systems when these all ultimately come together.
I can't wait to see them. I feel like we're ready to start getting
I don't know what else there is
building
to say.
Cabin.
We just gotta build them.
All right. Thank you for all these goodies, JJ. Can't wait for you to see what they look like.
I'm really excited to see how they turn out, so best of luck, guys.
Yeah, we'll send
Hopefully
you a picture.
Mine turns on.
So.
For now, we're both at the same state.
Yep.
Where we're putting in our power supply cables. Mm-hmm. And you guys might have noticed we have some fun additions that we're going to add onto those.
Bridget's got some bring up colors. I've got some Tough Gaming Alliance colors, so it's going to make a nice, good, solid color build for me and a much more complicated RGB multicolor build for Bridget.
I love it.
It's great.
I'm crazy. If I disappear from the frame a few times, that's just me crying in the corner, but I'll come back and I will finish it.
Yeah, with your little zip ties trying to get everything perfectly straight. Well, we do have some cable combs, so maybe that'll help straighten
things out. Oh, yes. So far, so good. So I guess we'll just keep going.
All right, Bridget, I think we've both arrived at a very daunting and highly contentious part of the build, where everybody has their own way of doing it, and they're all equally right in my eyes.
Except perhaps whatever I do.
Whatever we're about to do, everybody's going to insist is wrong.
Yes.
So here's the generally accepted way of doing thermal paste, the way that you apply thermal paste.
Okay.
Generally, you apply a small amount to the center of your die, right in the middle of your CPU, and then you put your cooler on top of that. So that's...
I mean, that sounds
basically
very simple.
Yeah, there's a couple things you can mess up if you put too much. You can kind of squeeze over the edges, which you want to avoid.
I'm going to start with like what I think is perhaps even too small. That way I can add
Let's go ahead and see
more.
What amount that you're going to put on this.
Oh my God, okay. We ready?
Yeah. Let's see, I'm going to judge
you. You're going to come over here and judge me live?
Over your shoulder.
Oh my God. Dee-dee-dee. Kevin, is that too much?
That's perfect. That's actually perfect.
Is it really?
Yeah. Yep, so make sure you put that on the right way the first time.
Oh God.
Cool. One thing you should avoid is picking it up after you've already kind of adhered it a little bit.
Uh-huh.
And then setting it back down. That can create air bubbles, which I know some people think is an issue and some people don't.
Is this on it? Oh my God.
Yeah, it's not, so this doesn't like, it's not going to snap into place or anything satisfying like that, unfortunately.
Yeah, I don't feel satisfied at
all. You're not. It's just kind of like
nervous. What's next, Kevin?
Next is all the fiddly difficult stuff.
Oh, great.
So we're almost there.
We haven't been doing that already?
No.
Cool.
Okay, we're in the home stretch, I think, as far as the build actually being done. We still have some a little bit more RGB stuff to work on.
Yes.
After this, but we are putting in the graphics cards, which can be close to final step.
Yeah. So I am shocked at how good it's looking when I look at it here.
Mm-hmm.
When I look at it from under, it gives me a lot of anxiety.
Yeah, that's why you cover up the bottom and you never address it ever again.
Mm-hmm. Just shove it all
just
down.
Just push it all down, like all those
anxious
bad memories. Just
all right.
Pretend it doesn't exist.
We got a 5700. Let's cheers.
Cheers. One thing I want to address. You can go ahead and put yours in. A feature on this particular model is really cool. I haven't seen this before. It's got a couple fan headers on it and an additional RGB header that both work as if you were plugging them directly into the motherboard, which is really great, especially for a small form factor build, because like we were saying earlier, they don't always have as many fan or RGB headers as you might like in a small system. So very good card for a small form factor build, although it is huge, but these chassis do seem to fit them just fine.
I think that's it.
Did you do it?
I think so. I guess that this is the moment of truth. Pretty scared, honestly, to see if it powers on.
Mm-hmm.
Do you want to go first?
No.
No?
You're going to go first.
Okay, so the tennis switch. I see a light.
There should be two little lights on your GPU, too, that show you, like...
Yep, there's lights.
In. Good, yeah.
Okay.
There's one more time.
What should happen?
Aww. One tap? Nope. Okay, so next step, there should be a power button on your motherboard.
Okay.
A little star button somewhere on there. Yeah, maybe you just put them in. There you go. So you put those headers on the wrong pins, the power switch thing on the wrong pins.
Okay, is that easy for me to fix?
You just got to put it on the right pins.
Okay, I'm feeling not anxious about
because this is not a very... Okay, there we go.
Oh, okay, cool, it works, of course.
solid. I also have a little RGB strip in here, which is nice. Nothing synced up because the software is not done yet.
Okay.
No keyboard detected. Okay, we could do something about that.
Okay.
All right, cool.
Well, we'll fix the stuff that I switcheroo'd and make it look really pretty.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yep. It's booting into Windows. Cool. So out of the two of them, which is your favorite?
Well, I mean, while you do have Tiny Dr. Lisa Sue, which is incredible, mm-hmm. I have the Bring Up logo on my CPU cooler.
So,
and these are the Bring Up colors in here.
That's true.
So I think as far as being on brand,
fair.
Mine is a little better. But I, you know, we should let the people decide. Mm-hmm. Just show some sexy B-roll of both of them and let us know which one you prefer in the comments.
Thanks,
Bridget.
Kevin. So, obviously, it was a big event for you.
Oh, yeah.
Major life-changing event.
Sure.
So how do you feel about it?
You know, I feel more powerful, obviously.
Right.
A lot cooler. I didn't
much
think
cooler.
I could get much cooler, but I did.
Yeah. You kept having sunglasses just appear on you, and you're like, I got to take off all these sunglasses because I'm so cool now.
But in all, you know, seriousness, I was shocked at how accessible it is. Mm-hmm. Like, it really was a lot easier than I thought it was going to be. Mm-hmm. I think to get the basic build, to get a computer that would just function and turn on and look nice, mm-hmm. like, that was achievable really pretty early on in the build.
Yeah.
And then everything else was just kind of like icing on top,
right.
that we were just choosing to do.
Sure.
So I think that if you've been intimidated, like I was for sure, with approaching your first PC build, I'd say, jump right on in. The water's fine.
Just go for
it. Don't have water near you, actually, during the build.
Please do not jump in water while building a PC.
But yeah, it definitely is something. It's like everything just goes where it's supposed to go.
Yeah, there's very few things that you can get very wrong. Well, we brought you Tiny Lisa, and Tiny Lisa's great, but I'll tell you what, doesn't even compare to the real thing.
Mm-mm.
So if you want to see actual, full-size, real Lisa here on the show, all you have to do is get to 5,000 likes on this episode, and we'll have her on as a very special guest.
That's all.
Mm-hmm.
Pretty easy.
Very simple.
Thank you guys so much, as always, for watching. If you have anything that you would like us to bring up, please let us know in the comments.
Mm-hmm.
And until next time, here's a little treat for you guys who stuck around to the end. Thanks.